So let's look at the first of our typing rules. That's for variable expressions, or var is the kind of short name we give them. If you haven't seen it already, I'd recommend the intro to this mini subseries. It kind of explains what the context is and how these videos are going to be structured. So without further ado, what is the rule? It looks a bit scary at first, especially kind of laid out like this, but let's break it down into its two component parts. So we said it's a rule, and from our syntax of kind of contexts and rules and predicates, all that, we can say the top part is a premise and the bottom part is a conclusion or judgment. And the way this works is we say if the premise is true, then the conclusion will be true. It's kind of like a if statement or an implication. So if the top thing is true, then the bottom thing will be true as well. What other pieces can we recognize from what we've seen before? Well, we've got this thing, X has type sigma. We've seen that a few times before, and this is an assignment where we have an expression, so in this case, our variable expression X, and then a colon means has type, and then the sigma here is just any kind of polytype. So you can substitute this in for a different polytype. Same with X, you're going to substitute it in for a different variable. We're saying X has type sigma in these assignments. And as we're saying, there are variables, and this is effectively what we're trying to find out the type of here. So if we have a variable, how do we find out its type? We use this typing rule. So let's try and read that rule through. I'll move it over to the side. And we'll start again by making it clear that we have this kind of if-then setup, right, where we have a premise and a conclusion. So let's dig into that premise. Well, we have that variable x, then we said the colon means has type, and then next we can say the polytype sigma. And then this next bit, I don't know if you remember back from contexts, is where we have an assignment. We can say whether it's in the context or not. So this next symbol is the set in symbol, whether it's in the context, capital gamma. And so that first premise, the top half, means if the variable x has type, a polytype sigma is in context gamma. So that's quite wordy, quite clunky, but it will start to make sense as we get through it. We'll also go through and simplify some of the language so it's not quite one-to-one mapping, but it will flow a bit better when we talk about it. So let's deal with the bottom half. So we've got the kind of ruler, which is the kind of then implication bit. From the context gamma, it follows that. So we talked about this turnstile symbol, meaning it follows that. And we've got the assignment again. So we're just stating the same thing. The variable x has type of polytype sigma. So you might look at this rule and you'll probably have one of two reactions. The first one is, wow, this makes no sense whatsoever. It's all just still symbols and some weird funky grammar of what you're trying to say. If you're that, then we'll keep going and you'll see hopefully from some of the examples as to what exactly this grammar and how this is all glued together. The second reaction you might have is, isn't this kind of obvious? Aren't we just kind of stating the same thing again twice? And if you think that, then you're also correct. We are effectively just pulling our assignment out of the context. But that's a valuable thing to do, and this is the simplest typing rule. As we continue and build this together, you'll see why it's useful to have this typing rule and basically be able to compose it with other typing rules to make more exciting type proofs. So let's continue on and see that example. So we can remember our rule here where we have x has type sigma is in the context, means that from the context it follows that x has type sigma. Let's say we have an example context, capital gamma, which has two assignments. The first assignment is age has type int, and the second assignment is odd has type int to bool. You'll see as we go through the series, we'll use these and a few others as kind of canonical examples of some functions or some variables we'll have. And we want to ask the question, what is the type of the expression age given the context gamma? Another way you might phrase this is, given that we have this context, age has type int and odd has type int to bool, what is the type of age? And again, it seems like a very obvious, silly question. And yes, this is a very straightforward kind of just restating rule effectively. We can translate this into symbols if we said, from the context, it follows that age has what type, you know, some question marks in the type we're expecting. Then if we look at our rule, well, this actually looks a lot like the bottom of our rule on the top left, where we have from the context gamma, it follows that X is type sigma, or we want from the context gamma, it follows that age has type what. So let's try substituting this into the rule. So we'll say if we substitute in for the rule where X is going to be age and sigma is going to be int, what does that leave us with? Well, we end up basically with this rule which says age has type int being in the context means that from the context it follows that age has type int. And for this to hold, we need the premise to hold. Remember, it's an if-then. So let's think about this. Is age has type int in the context? Well, if we look on the context on the left, yeah, age has type int is in the context. So that means the conclusion, the thing at the bottom, holds. So we do know that age has type int. And if we look at the question we were trying to answer, that is effectively what we were trying to do. And so we've answered our question, the expression age has type int. And you might say, what have you been doing just messing around? Like, we knew that from the context straight away. And the point of these typing rules is for a compiler with no kind of sense of, you know, what is obvious, it can just apply different rules and it will get somewhere. So you'll see later that it can't just apply the rules because there are a few tricky parts with instantiation and generalization, which is where the Hindley-Milner algorithms come into play to tell us which ways we apply those rules. But effectively, we can check certain things like is age has type int in the context, and then we conclude certain judgments like from the context it follows that age has type int. So let's go back and look at the rule. Maybe we can think about a bit of intuition that we can get to understand the rule a bit better. So again, when we read it out, we read it as if the variable X has type of polytype sigma is in the context gamma, then from the context gamma, it follows that the variable X has type of polytype sigma. So let's try and simplify this. Again, we're going to lose a bit of the, you know, perfect logical accuracy, but we're doing it in the sake of clarity. So hopefully that will make more sense. Let's try and understand it. If the context contains some assignment, so for example, X has type sigma is contained in the context. So if the context contains some assignment, then that assignment follows from the context. So from capital gamma, it follows that X has type sigma. An alternative, maybe even simpler, broad brush view of this is that we can pull things out of the context. So if we have an assignment in the context, well, we can say that assignment must be true if it's in the context. If this all makes sense to you, you can probably skip to the next video. Otherwise, if you still haven't quite wrapped your head around it, I recommend you think about this analogous rule. And also, if you're just curious, maybe you'll be interested in watching this. So let's say we have this rule for algebra, where we say, if the variable X has value V under our axioms A, then from the axioms A, it follows that the variable X has value V. Again, maybe this is also a bit silly, but bear with me. Let's say X equals 3, right? In our axioms, so our axioms are statements that we think are true. And we say, you know, just like you get an exam question at the beginning, it says, given that X equals 3 and Y equals 4, what is X? Well, then the top part is the bit that we're looking at in the axioms. So we say, well, X equals 3 was in the axioms. And at the bottom, well, the question is, what is X's value that follows from the axioms? And the answer is we can pull it out of those axioms. We can say X equals 3. And so, yes, you probably want to do a question that is more interesting, right? You probably wouldn't ask someone sensibly, you know, well, if X is 3 and Y is 4, what is X? You'd probably ask them, what is X plus Y, right? But this allows you to do the first step where you can say, well, actually, I'm going to refer back to the axioms here, pull out X and Y, and then you might use a different rule to compose those two different variables. Again, thinking about the intuition that I gave for the variable typing rule, rephrasing it in that way, if the set of axioms we have contains some assignment, so you know that capital A contains X equals V, then the assignment follows from our axioms. So from A, it follows that X equals V. And alternatively, we can pull things out of our axioms. And by things, I mean, you know, statements that assign values to variables. Taking it even further, we can do an example with the analogous rule. So let's say you're given an exam question which says A equals 3 and B equals 4, and you're asked, what is the value of A? Well, you have to have some process for getting that. And the process you can go through is where you can say, well, we're being asked from the axioms, it follows that A has what value? we can substitute that in for the rule, where we can say, well, the variable x looks a lot like the variable a, the value v, it looks a lot like the value 3 in our kind of context. We can put this in our rule, and we can say, well, the top part holds, right? Because a equals 3 is in our axioms. And the bottom part tells us, well, from our axioms, it follows that a has value 3, which is the thing we were trying to prove. And so we can say the expression a has value 3 at the end of it. To be clear, this analogous rule is just something silly I made up. If the variable rule made sense to you and this one didn't, that's absolutely fine. This one is not part of Hindley-Milner. Again, you don't need to remember this or learn it as part of any kind of Hindley-Milner stuff. It's just a way that may frame it for some people in a way that they understand better. And just to cement that learning in, let's do another example, this time back with typing rules. So here we have the variable rule again. We've got our same context where we have our context with age as type int and odd has type int to bool. And we're asked, what is the type of odd given the context gamma? And if you remember what that's asking, we're basically saying from the context gamma, it follows that odd has some type. We want to figure out what that type is. Again, we can figure out how to match the rule to that. So we can say, well, in this case, our variable is odd, so the x is going to be odd. And if we look at the context, well, our sigma is going to be int to bool. Substituting these in for the rule, we get that if odd has type int to bool is in the context, which it is, you can see on the left, then it follows from the context that odd has type int to bool. And so we can conclude that odd has type int to bool. Hopefully some of those examples have helped you understand the variable typing rule a bit more. If you're still a bit confused, I'd recommend just continuing on with the next couple of videos and see if anything clicks or anything makes slightly more sense. The variable one is in some sense a very simple rule, and in other senses a weird one to grok or understand just because of almost how simple it is. So maybe continue with the next videos and then come back to this one if you're still stuck. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one where we'll look at the function application typing rule.